Welcome to Life Hacks, Biohacking Life Hacks. I'm a biohacker. It just means I love finding ways to optimize my life. That's what it really means. How to improve my life, optimize it, make myself healthier, better performance, all that. That's all it means. It's just a fancy word for that term. And the idea is that you're not just hacking computers, you're hacking your biology. So that's biohacking. It's amazing. It's only been around for like 10-15 years, but it's a massively growing industry. So here, the reason for this podcast is to find out other people's biohacks or how they've optimized their life, because you know everybody has done it in something. Mm-hmm. You know, like maybe somebody really found a really optimum way of tying shoelaces. You know, like, so I'd love to know about all these people's life hacks so I can see, maybe learn from it and then incorporate it into my life. And you know, so,
nice.
Yeah. So Laura, you're in Texas, did you say, right?
Yes, United States.
Yeah. Texas. Is that where the Cowboys are, right? I mean,
the Dallas Cowboys, yeah.
Okay. I remember Dallas. There used to be that series on TV called Dallas. J.R. Ewing or something. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Something like that. That was
That was a while ago. I think that was the 70s. Yeah.
Yeah. Something like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He was big. I remember I was this, you know, child and I used to run home to go and watch that.
Fun.
Yeah. Yeah. So tell me, Laura. Tell me exactly who Laura Cohen is. And what makes a tick, and you know?
Yeah, well, you know, I've been really discovering my purpose even more lately. I'm a Jewish believer in Jesus, and I'm an artist. And it's interesting because 24 years ago, I was married, I was working a job, and I was really not very good at it. I think I was just. I was struggling, and I think I struggled a lot when I was younger because I didn't know how to live. I didn't really understand how to be the person that I wanted to be. And I was working in a department store in Beverly Hills on Wilshire Boulevard, you know, I had arrived in retail, you know, in terms of work. And I was just so conflicted. And I just prayed to God and I said, God, is this really what you created me to be? Is this what my life is supposed to be? Am I living my truth for you? I said, because if I am, you really need to help me. I'm terrible at this. I am really not good. I mean, this is not working. And because I didn't have a kindness or a softness in my heart. I wanted to be this person that I couldn't be. And it was frustrating. And I said to God in this prayer, it's like, you know, if I only want to live my truth for you, I've always really loved God and I've always wanted to be with him. And I don't think I could really grasp and understand God all that well. And I said, just anything that's not my truth, take it away. And I would not recommend that prayer for anybody because a week and a half later, I was exposed to a lot of chemicals from a shipment of clothing that came in and I was chemically injured. I was on disability for 5 years and I was 36 years old. That's supposed to be the prime of my life. And I got so sick over a period of 3 years, I couldn't walk a mile. And it was really interesting because I kind of went through a loss of my life and my identity and who am I and all of that. And when I went to my doctor at one point and I said, you know, how is this my truth? I prayed to God and I asked him for my truth. Why am I sick? What's going on? This doesn't make any sense to me. And he just looked at me and he said, why don't you come back in 3 months? You know, because he had no answer. And I just kept saying, you know, this can't be my truth. I'm not here to be like this messed up chronic person, you know, like really sick and everything. And it took a long time for me like I went through a lot of changes and things like that. And I've always loved being an artist. And, you know, for a period of time I was writing music and, you know, in this journey that I've had with the Lord, it's like Sometimes I'm doing art, sometimes I'm not. And fast forward a little bit, when I was in church and I was 44 years old, and I was with some friends, and I had been in churches before. It wasn't a big deal, but I really felt God there. And I was listening to the pastor talking, and he's talking about pennies and how people are important. And he said, "You know, God is a gentleman. Jesus is a gentleman. You know, he is not going to come where he's not invited, and he won't stay where he's not welcome. And you need to invite Jesus into your heart." He said, "You have to ask him to fill you with the Holy Spirit and to be your Lord and Savior, and he'll forgive you of your sins." And I could feel God there, and I'm like, you know, I have tried everything but Jesus. You know, I had tried being an Orthodox Jewish person. I had tried, I had done Indian sweat lodges. I had tried all the New Age stuff. I mean, I was searching. I was like, you know, I want to feel better. What is it? You know, I was trying to find anything I could. And it was really interesting because I was like, okay, fine, God, you know, I did the altar call. I went up there and I'm like, all right, Jesus. There wasn't any question to me that I had done a lot wrong. I mean, it wasn't hard for me to say, okay, I've sinned, or, you know, I've made mistakes. It's like, okay, I need forgiveness. And forgiveness sounded really good to me. And I needed to forgive myself, I think. And so I asked him to be my Lord and Savior. I asked him to fill me with the Holy Spirit. I didn't think anything was really going to happen. I mean, I was a Jewish person. Jews don't believe in Jesus. And, you know, no one ever told me he was God. And then, you know, but I was filled with the Holy Spirit. And that was like unbelievable, because it was like this peace came over me, and I was like, wow, this is really cool. And my friends asked me, they're like, you know, are you okay? I'm like, yeah. And they're like, you sure? And I'm like, yeah, I mean, I'll try Jesus. Let's see what he can do. If this doesn't work, I guess I can try Buddha next. I really didn't know. And I thought, okay. And I started this journey with the Lord. And then he showed me later that he was God. And I'm like, all of these years, I have been praying to you and pouring my heart out, God, I love you. And then I would turn around and I would blaspheme Jesus because I didn't know he was God. So, you know, here I'm, you know, loving him and thinking he, you know, the God of my understanding. And then I find out that, you know, Jesus, who I used as a cuss word, and Jesus, who I, you know, didn't regard and thought nothing of and didn't believe anything about him, is like the God I've been praying to for all these years. And I'm like, okay. Good to know. Thanks for letting me know. And you know, I've been through a second marriage and divorce, and he's taught me so much through all of the things that he's done with me. And the thing that's really amazing is how much he can design things for us. And all of the pieces and all the people and all the details, so that the timing's perfect. And he's just shown me over the years that he's got a plan that's amazing. And I can truly trust everything he's doing. And I just have to kind of like follow what I get in my heart, you know, what I feel directed on from him. And I make tons of mistakes, you know, and I get forgiven. And you know, and he keeps giving me opportunities to grow and to be a better person, you know. And I think, like, a lot of the wisdom, one thing that was interesting to me is, you know, a lot of the wisdom that I had studied and, you know, the New Age things and everything like that, a lot of it comes from the Bible. And I didn't know that until I had read the Bible, because I had never read it. Like, Proverbs 23:7 is, you know, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Well, that's classic New Age. And then science comes into it as well. I was looking at Adam and Eve. And have you ever looked at superposition? Do you know about that in quantum physics?
Yes, I have.
Okay.
I used to study quantum physics. I love it here.
Okay. So God gave me this kind of idea that was really amazing to me. So, in quantum physics, superposition, things are not positive or negative until they're observed. And so, when somebody observes it, then it becomes positive or negative for them. So, we get to choose, and we have our own experience. Well, in the Garden of Eden, before Adam and Eve ate the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they didn't have any knowledge of what evil was. They didn't have that. So they were in a state of superposition, which was the state of love. And it was just God. And as soon as they ate that fruit and they received that knowledge of good and evil, suddenly their brain was making these decisions. That's when sin came in. That's when death came in. And the thing that's interesting is that my brain is so accustomed to making these decisions of judging something good or bad or anything like that. And there's this moment, and it's really small, before my mind will make a decision about whether something's good or bad. And so I got into this thing where I wanted to just learn how to stop my brain from deciding something and judging it. You know, and back in November, God's like, you've got to stop judging. And I was like, yeah, I'm opinionated. Yeah, I do have that. But the thing that's really interesting is that when I'm not looking at something as good or bad, I'm just looking at as it is. And I'm looking at God as, you know, he's holy and he's perfect and he's good and he's loving. And when we are living in gratitude and when we embody these kinds of things and we're making those decisions, we get closer to him. And when we're choosing the negative and we're choosing, you know, the anger or the grief or the jealousy or, you know, what would be called sin, you know, the negative side of things, we've moved far away. And so it's been really interesting to just look at, okay, I'm not going to judge this as identifying it as a good or evil. I'm just going to say, okay, God, you're good. And I don't know what you're doing, but I know it's going to be good. And it's amazing what he does in my life. I mean, I've got tons of God stories of like things he does that are miraculous. And it's so much fun because the one thing that I think is really nice is that it enables me to be kinder. And there's a part in 1 Peter chapter 3. I remember I hadn't been a Christian for very long, and I came across this verse, and it talks about how the beauty of a woman is in her quiet and gentle spirit. And I thought, well, I'm not that quiet and I'm not that gentle. And if that's where my real beauty is, I better start working on it because I'm not getting any younger. You know, I mean, in the sense of like, you know, I was already in my late 40s. It's like, okay, so that beauty of kindness and that beauty of gentle and quietness, what I've noticed is that as I've spent time focused on being that kind of person, my health is better and I feel better and there isn't any stress in my life. You know, I sometimes can get triggered or something like that, but for the most part, it's like it's pretty chill.
Nice.
Yeah.
I was just listening to you there. You mentioned forgiveness. Yeah.
Yeah.
There's actually a lot of science behind forgiveness.
It's pretty powerful.
That they can actually detect it now in the brain. So if they connect enough electrodes around your head and they get ask you to forgive somebody, they can actually detect when you actually forgive somebody. Like they can go, ah, oh, no, you actually haven't forgiven them. Oh, you have now. And because the brain changes, the structure of the brain changes, and there's actually a program, and I'm sure there's more than one now, but this is like quite an old program. It's called 40 Years of Zen. And what they do is they connect a whole lot of electrodes because in biohacking, forgiveness is a very big thing. And so they'll collect a whole lot of electrodes with some scientists there, and he'll be like, okay, well, who are the people you need to forgive? And you go, okay, I need to forgive my, let's say, ex-wife. And you go, oh, I forgive my ex-wife. And they go, no, try again, try again. And
That's so
then
funny.
so this person will help you, guide you in how to forgive. And then as soon as you forgive, then the plasticity of the brain changes, the structure. And that program is called 40 Years of Zen. And what they do is they do six of these kind of things. And one of them is forgiveness. Nice. And it totally changes your whole brain, like completely.
Yeah, it's funny. There's a story in the Bible where a couple of the disciples go to Jesus and they say, okay, so if my brother sins against me, how many times should I forgive him? Seven? Like, that's, like, I'm going to be really good. I'm going to forgive this person seven times for doing these bad things. And Jesus looks at him and says, no, 70 times seven. And it's like, and I think it's like, by the time if you just get in the habit of I'm forgiving, because anger causes really bad health issues. Holding anger, resentment, being critical, being negative causes a lot of difficulty. And I remember when I did get sick, when I was exposed to chemicals and things like that, I was dealing with a lot of frustration. I was dealing with a lot of conflict inside, and it had to do with not really having the kind of heart that I needed to in order to have health and in order to have peace. And I needed to have that with Jesus ultimately, but I needed to be able to be with God. God created us. And I find that the love and just the beauty of what comes into my spirit and what comes into my life because of being able to be with the Lord. And He is, I mean, He created everything, He knows everything, and it's just so much fun to be able to be with Him. And he just does amazing stuff. Like, I moved into this house that I'm in, and I got it about a year ago. And it needed a lot of work. I mean, it really needed a lot of work. I had to level the foundation, and then every single door frame and window, there were cracks everywhere. I mean, like every single room, the ceilings, it's like it looked like really odd for about a week while everything was getting settled on these piers, and I had to have everything patched up. There was so much work that had to be done initially. And when I the sellers of the house had put a new roof on before I moved in. And so back in April, there was a hailstorm, and there were these, golf ball size hail that were, coming down. And I was praying to God, I'm like, please protect my car. Just please protect my car. And I was looking outside. I went to film the hail, to show my mom. And I'm watching these hailstones just get thrown over and around my car, not one ding, but it hit my roof, it hit my gutters, it hit the window frames, And this new roof, some of these shingles actually had holes in them. These things were hitting so hard. So I was like, all right, well, thank you for protecting my car. Well, I ended up filing an insurance claim for homeowners insurance. And the thing that was so interesting about it is that the insurance company covered replacing the roof because because of the damage. Well, when the roofer came out, he And they were taking off the roof. The roofer who had put the new roof on didn't take off the felting that they were supposed to, so they didn't install the roof correctly. And I was like, I mean, I had no idea, but God knew. And we dedicated this house to him. It's his house, so it's like, he did a hailstorm, so he replaced the roof, he replaced the gutters, he's replaced all this stuff, and it's a lot. And he just takes care of that for me. So sometimes when he brings stuff to me, it's like it may not seem like it's a great thing. Sometimes it's a little bit of a process and there may be, a minor inconvenience, but he just keeps delivering over and over again. I've been working for this guy for like 9 out of the last 11 and a half years, and he's had different businesses, and I mostly do sales for him. And because I'm not making my living as an artist, but it's funny because God has grown me so much in this job, and I have not always been, I've been a piece of work for God, I can say that, and I haven't always been that great under pressure. I haven't always been great when things have stressed me out. I've had to really, learn things and grow up differently than what I thought. And I would get so frustrated sometimes, and I'd be like, I just want to do something else. And then he would have my boss come in and offer me a different position or move me to do something else. So it's like always, like, okay, fine. I'd get really aggravated. And it's like, okay, now you're going to do this. And that's like, okay, great. Now you're back over here. Okay, now I'm going to have you here. And it's like, and he just keeps taking care of me. It's pretty amazing.
So I'm a massive student of Tantra yoga basically.
Okay.
I don't know if you know what yoga means. Yoga
No, I
means
don't.
yoga is the whole system of yoga. It's only designed to do one thing, and it's basically yoga is a technology. It's a system. It's a very complex technology. And the whole point of yoga is to create a complete union with God. That's it.
Oh, interesting. I didn't know that.
All the training in yoga, the whole thing, everything is designed to help you create a union with God. And in yoga and in Eastern philosophy, we have enlightened beings. I don't know if you've heard of them. An
No.
enlightened being is it's just somebody who's done so much work on themselves that they have finally managed to do create a complete union with God, complete and permanent union with God. And so they live, so they're fully connected and they're fully open and they live in pure bliss and everything just happens around them, like.
That's interesting, 'cause in with Jesus, he does that. When Jesus became my Lord and Savior, he filled me with the Holy Spirit. So I became God's child. And so it wasn't because I did anything, and it wasn't there wasn't anything I could do to earn that. When I asked Jesus, hey, I need you, please do this for me, he did. And it's been amazing because the peace inside of me, even when I've gone through stuff, and life happens, and it's not always like, oh, I love this. It's like, I remember when I was first saved, it was like, things would happen, and James, Jesus's half brother, he's got a chapter in the Bible, and he says, count it all joy when you encounter various trials. And I'd just be like, I'm not joyful. I'm not counting this joy. What does this mean? And then, it talks about how it creates character and perseverance and all these things. But what I realize is that when I'm joyful, when I'm grateful, when I'm in a mode of just appreciation and really honoring God and worshiping God and feeling that, there's nothing that can, Satan can't come near me. There isn't any power in anything that's negative because I'm in joy. And so when my response is joyful, because it's like, well, I'm not judging it as bad anymore, because if it's coming from God and he's in control, it's going to be good. So, there's no worry there. I suddenly don't have any fear. And then I have this joy inside of me. There isn't anything that's going to disturb me. And it comes from having the Holy Spirit and having the Lord and really reading the word. And the thing that's interesting is, I don't know if you've ever, have you ever read the Bible? Okay. I had never read the Bible and I didn't really know very much about it. Here I'm a Jewish person and I knew Jesus was Jewish, but I didn't know the early apostles were Jewish, and I didn't know that all the early Christians were Jews, because Jesus, he's the Jewish Messiah. He came for the Jews. And then there was a guy named Saul who became the Apostle Paul. A lot of Catholics and people know him. So he was the one who went to the Gentiles. And so it was just really interesting. I didn't really know very much about it, but when I started reading the Bible, it's like, that book is alive. That book is amazing, because, and I don't understand everything in it. Some of it's just confusing, and then some of it's just like, genealogies. Like the names of these people is like amazing, but God's really there with me when I read the Bible. And there's so much wisdom and so many things that are part of other cultures. A lot of the ancient wisdom or the New Age stuff, it's all in the Bible. There's a part in Philippians, it's a letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Philippi. And he's talking about, whatever's true, whatever's lovely, whatever's noble, whatever's, think about these things. If it's lovely, if it's righteous, think about the good. He talks about praying without ceasing, with thanksgiving. And the thing is that, that instruction really works because if I'm always thinking of good, that's what I'm going to get. And that's what I'm going to be bringing to myself is because that's all I'm paying attention to. When people are focused on the problems, that's all they keep bringing themselves. So, there's some very practical things about how to live to be close with God. And it's the way it was designed. What I love about science and the things that the scientists are discovering is that it's everything that God has in the Bible of what he created for us. And he made it so that we could have this amazing time. And I was always like, okay, why am I having so much trouble? And why is this going on? I'm supposed to be in bliss here. I'm supposed to be having a good time. Why am I not having a good time? And it's because I didn't know how to think. And I didn't understand my free will. We all have free will, and that's an amazing gift that God gives us. And it's something that's very, very precious for every single person to have. You get to choose what is going to be what you want. But what I didn't understand is that when a thought came in my mind, I had the ability to choose whether or not I wanted to think that. Or whether or not I wanted to have that as a belief. And there were things that I had taken on from being a kid or, being in my family or being around people who were just doing whatever they were doing. And I had ended up taking on a bunch of stuff that I didn't really want inside of me. And I had to go through this process of learning, well, why am I believing that? And I think everybody comes to a point in their life, usually probably when they, are past, I guess that's why they call it a midlife crisis sometimes. But I think it's, there's a point where everyone comes to their life and says, well, why am I like this if I'm, why am I doing this if I'm unhappy? Or, how am I going to be happy? Or they just accept that I'm, well, this was how it was for my dad. I'm going to be this way. And the good news is that nobody has to be in bondage. We get freedom. And, the Lord is so kind. And I remember there was a friend of mine who was a born again Christian before I gave my life to Jesus. And I love talking about God because he's my favorite. He's my favorite. And we were talking. She always knew things in the Bible. And I thought that was the coolest thing. I'm like, wow, that's in the Bible? That's really neat. And then she told me about how she had been forgiven and how Jesus had forgiven her and how he was so kind and so loving to her. And I thought, that's really nice. I never thought I would go to Jesus, and I remember telling my mother, I'm an adult child, so she can't like do an intervention or think I've lost my mind, by giving my life to Christ. But I said, don't worry about it. I'm not going to become like one of those Bible thumper people. And I'm like totally a Bible thumper person now, It's like, I just want to tell people, Jesus is really amazing, and I know there's a lot of stuff out there that's really confusing, but he loves us. He came, this is what blows me away. He came to earth to live a perfect life that we could never live. He died on a cross to take the sin of everybody. He paid for everybody's sin in the entire world, anyone who's ever lived, anyone who will live. And then he rose again on the third day to defeat death so we could have eternal life and we could be with God if when we believe in him. And he knew when he went on that cross that there were a lot of people who were not going to take him up on it. He knew they were not going to believe. He knew that they were never going to want to have anything to do with him. And he died and took the penalty for their sin. So if by any chance they decided that they wanted to be forgiven, they could have it for free.
So, Laura, let me ask you something. So in East, so I study Eastern philosophy and yoga and all that kind of stuff. And in Eastern philosophy, they describe God like in detail. Like it's like a science, you know, like it's like the nth degree, you know, like down to the molecule. So it'd be interesting to compare what you think God is and what like yoga thinks God is. Like I'd love to compare the two. So what do you think God is?
Well, God's the creator, and he knows everything. He's everywhere, and he's all powerful, and he's really beyond my comprehension in a lot of ways. But that's kind of the basics of it. And then there's the Trinity. There's God the Father, God the Son, Jesus came down. And then there's the Holy Spirit. So God the Father is God around us. Jesus is God who is with us. And the Holy Spirit is God who is inside of us.
If I can quickly explain in yoga, so God is so there's God lives in so that how can I describe it? Yeah, so there's duality and non-duality. Non-duality means before duality, you know, and what we call is 36 tapas, yeah, and basically it means so right at the top zero. It's where it's just consciousness. So God basically in yoga is consciousness, and the whole of existence, all of creation is just consciousness. And this consciousness exists everywhere. There's no such thing as any space that isn't consciousness.
Yeah,
You know,
that's
like,
omnipotence, yeah.
yeah. And so then this consciousness then decides whatever it is, to start manifesting. So this consciousness goes through these levels and creates more so that so at the top it's just consciousness and it's all light, and then it creates more heavier elements, and it keeps going down these until number 36, where it eventually creates physical reality. And so at some point, I think it's number six or something, five or six, it creates two. So there's just one at the top, and then that one then splits into two, which is Shiva and Shakti, masculine and feminine. And then the masculine and feminine then make love, and then that then creates the rest of creation, rest of the physical world. And the physical world, which is all of reality, and then this means the universe as well, is basically a thought inside of God's head. And so when so what God is doing, he's it's just consciousness. He's manifesting reality. And so this happens, I think it's like a trillion times a second, right? So he manifests reality, so he goes through all these levels, and then at the end of it creates the physical reality that we have.
Interesting.
And then he pulls that back, and then he creates again. You know, like the way a TV refreshes, the screen refreshes. So he's creating all of the whole universe, like a trillion times a second. So it gets created, and then it disappears. Let me just start there. Yeah, so basically, and so God is creating all of the universe like a trillion times a second, and then there's that gap. So the gap is really important. The gap is when it goes back to nothing. And
I've never
so,
heard that before.
all right, so this is like it's deep. Like I've been a student of yoga for like 5 years now, and I grew up thinking yoga was an exercise like this, you know, that, you know,
Stretching and everything, yeah.
and but it is part of yoga, but it's only like 1%. It's like it, so In yoga, what they see is that it's when we're born, there's a massive amount of energy comes into us to
Okay.
create, to ignite it. And that energy is called Kundalini energy, right? And that energy comes down the chakras. So we have seven chakras, the top one, and then all the chakras, and then there's the base chakra. And so the Kundalini energy comes and it gets trapped or locked or something in the bottom chakra. And all these exercises we do, all these yoga postures, all this is tuning our bodies to become realigned and also to release the chakras. And so then once you release the chakras to balance them out, then the Kundalini energy can then rise back up. And so when you become an enlightened being, what you've done is you've released and opened up all your chakras so that the Kundalini energy rises, and now you're fully realized being.
I
And
think being with Jesus is easier. You just ask him
yeah.
for his forgiveness and he fills you with the Holy Spirit and you're there.
Yeah. Oh, of course. Yeah. But it's like what's the word I'm thinking? Yeah, it's basically like they've turned it literally into a science, but and in yoga, you're permanently always connected to God, right? All the time. And by the way, in yoga, and in Buddhism as well, Buddhism is very similar. And they say in Buddhism, there's no God. It's not technically true. There is a God, but they don't see it in the way that you're seeing God. In yoga, they see God in a way, as a, describe it. It's a lot harder to describe these things than I thought it would be. So for example, okay, so God, you, this computer, somebody else over there, they're all one and the same thing. They're not separate. So in all of creation, there is no separateness. Everything is one, right? And then
That's different, yeah.
that one then splits into two. And so in Hinduism, there's like a million gods. And the reason is because everybody sees reality in a different way, right? So some people will go, oh, I'm a farmer, I want to worship, I don't know, the farming yoga, the god or something, right? So they'll create a god, but you can't separate them out. You can't separate anything out from God. Like I am God, you're God, this molecule in the air is God. Like there's no separation between them. It's
Well,
all
I'm
one.
definitely not God.
Okay, well,
I'm definitely not God. I mean, I'm created by God and I'm a part of his creation, but there is a creator.
oh yeah,
So
there is a creator,
there is a creator. So yeah.
but
And
that creator is you. So
no,
in yoga.
I've been created and I've been created in his image, but I am not the creator.
Okay.
Like
What?
I'm not eternal. In Christ I will be. But I was born, like I don't know everything the way God knows everything, but I'm now his child.
It's because the reason you don't know, according to yoga, by the technology in
It's
yoga,
different, yeah,
it
okay.
is yeah, it's just a different way of thinking about it, is that but there's a veil put in front of you, right? Or a series of veils in front of you, like a fog.
Huh.
And basically, so all the information is available to you, but there's this fog in front of you. And yoga, the training in yoga is to remove that fog. And so in yoga, so when the one being separates into two, one is called Shakti and the other is called Shiva. And so as a man, I am an embodiment of Shiva, the masculine. And as a woman, you are the embodiment of Shakti, right? And so at my core, I am Lord Shiva, right? And at your core, you're Shakti. And when you do all the yoga training where you're opening and realigning your chakras and allowing that Kundalini energy to rise, at some point you come to that realization. And yoga is all about experiences. So what the in the teaching they teach us is that you don't believe anything we tell you, that nothing is true for you. Like if I have a, like if I ride a bike right there, and I go, oh, I've ridden a bike, but you've never seen a bike, right? So I go, well, bikes are real, and I can, you know, when we can ride them, that's true for me, but it's not true for you. Until you ride a bike, then you go, oh yeah, bikes are real, you know, you can balance on bikes. And so yoga is all about experiencing things yourself. So until you experience it yourself, it's just a story. And so
kind of like this, trying to tell someone how what chocolate's like if they've never eaten it, that's what they look at it.
And so it's all about experiencing. So in yoga, God is always talking to you, like constantly, but he's whispering. And when you meditate, the idea is you bring your mind, you calm your mind so much so that you can detect the whispers from God. There's this special meditation that's just mental, by the way. It's a 10-day, it's called Vipassana, and it's a 10-day silent meditation, and you meditate for 10 to 12 hours a day. They're really trying to get you to do, meditate for 24 hours a day, yeah? But for 12 of those hours, you're sitting there meditating, but the rest of the time, you're supposed to stay in meditation. So it's literally 24-hour meditation for 10 days in complete silence.
Have you done that?
Yeah, 5 times.
Wow, what was that like?
Oh, it's insane. I mean, like, it's, I don't know, have you ever taken psychedelics?
No.
All right. Okay, I was going to explain. It's like taking a psychedelic. It's basically what happens to your brain and in your experience. It's insane. Like, you would think, just sitting there, close your eyes, and they tell you what to do in the head, right? So on day one, they tell you, this is what we want you to do. And so you sit there, and you keep doing that thing in your head over and over and over and over again. And then the next day, they change it slightly, right? And then the next day, they change it again. And I think by day 3, you're doing what the actual thing, but they have to, you know, baby step you to it. And then on the 3rd day, they go, right, this is the actual thing we want you to do. But this was just preparation, right? And so then it's like a calculation, and you keep doing it, like, over and over again. So you're just sitting there, and you just do this over and over and over, and then for hours, days. And it is quite taxing on the brain. You know, it's like me saying to you, calculate 2 plus, you know, doubling numbers, and you just sit there doubling numbers for days or weeks, whatever, right? But oh my God, I think it's about day 5 or 6, you're just doing this, and your brain is like, and your brain gets upgraded to insane levels, by the way, that on at the end of the 1st day, you're tired, like insanely tired. It's like you just run, like, I don't know, 10 marathons in your head, you know, and you are like really tired. And then the next day you're also tired, you know, like, but what happens by day 3 is your brain sort of upgrades itself, because you're doing all this work in there. It literally goes up a level. So by day 3, you're not tired anymore, because it's like you've upgraded it. So it can handle that workload now.
Okay.
And then I think it depends on the person. Day 5 or 6, you have a breakthrough. And this breakthrough is insane. Like, if you haven't taken psychedelics, like, do you know what psychedelics are?
Not really.
Oh my God, okay. Psychedelics is probably the best way to describe it, is a substance from God which allows you to open the gateways directly to God.
Open the gateways for what?
To God. Opens up. Like, it makes you realize. It connects you directly to God, basically. That's what a psychedelic does. This is why people love it so much. Yeah. But it does it only for a short period of time. You know, some
Okay.
psychedelics like DMT will open up a portal to God, and you go straight up for 15, 20 minutes. Right? And again, it depends on how much you take. So, from what I can figure out, these are my experiences, right? What I can
Right.
figure out, the whole of the universe is like a shell. And then there's in and the but that is inside a shell, another shell, another shell, another shell, another shell, and the shell keeps building, right? And then right, if you go outside of this shell completely, out of the universe, out of all the shells, you end up in nothingness, where there's nothing there, and all there is you, and all there is God, basically, right? And
Huh.
when you take psychedelics, it allows you to go up through these different shells of the universe. You know, like an onion. So you can think of the onion is the universe. And then outside the onion is where God lives, where there's no time, no space, nothing. It's the nothingness, right? And when you take a psychedelic, you're going through the layers of the onion to go out. And so the more you take, the further you go, right? And different psychedelics work in different ways. So like, for example, DMT shoots you up 10 levels and then you go up the level. Mushrooms, for example, slowly takes you up the level. And
Huh.
if you take enough mushrooms, you'll eventually break out into nothingness. And it's the same with LSD. LSD does the same thing. A bufo is a special one. It's from a toad in the in America somewhere, Sarinjan Desert or something it's called. But it's a toad. It's called a bufalaris or something,
Okay.
and it gives off on his skin a poison which is called which will kill anything, right? But what
Okay.
man has learned to do, or the Indians have learned to do, is they've when it flakes off the toad. It's like crystals now because they've dried, right? And so
Okay.
you can powder that crystal and smoke it. And so the shamans know how to do this, right? And when you smoke this, what this one, this is no, I would say this is the most powerful psychedelic on the planet. It teleports you, boom, straight out of that onion completely. And you go straight to nothingness. And it's amazing. But it will do it for 20 minutes to 2 hours maximum, and then you're back down. But what yoga does is it trains your whole physiology and your brain and your mind to go up these levels in the onion, you know. But you're going up really slowly, right, through these levels because you're doing it with training. But each time you go up a level, it's permanent. You live there. Do you know what I mean? And a fully enlightened being, he's gone up, slowly trained himself to go up these onion levels, and he lives permanently in those levels. And each those levels, as you go up those levels, gives you superpowers. And then
You have
eventually,
superpowers with that?
yes,
What
that's
kind of
right.
superpowers?
Right. So level one is the root chakra, right? So that's survival. So that's where you're living in fear, you're living in survival, security. You're not a fully realized man or woman, right? And all you're caring about is your environment, like a caveman, for example. You know, like and so most people live at this level, you know, where they live in fear and they're always thinking about, well, I've got to pay the rent, survival, security. Food, you know, that's where all that comes from. So people who are just focused on those things, they're living at level one, right? And then level two is where it's they add the desire in there, and the desire is the desire to connect, the desire to reproduce. So now you've taken care of your survival needs, so you moved up a level to level two, where now you think and think about other things like like reproduction, like connecting with others, you know, like that kind of stuff. And then level three is Manipura willpower, right? It's now where you become a human being. Level three, like a full, fully complete human being. Maybe I'm not explaining it right, but that kind of concept, yeah. And at that level, you have willpower, you have discipline, and that's what you're developing. And it's what entrepreneurs, for example, live at, because it allows you to get shit done in the world, you know. And so if you want to, so there's so it in the postures and in the meditations, they're all connected to each of the postures connected to one of those chakras. And so it's designed to help you open and energize and align that chakra. So like there's a series of chakra postures you can do and meditations, for example, for the heart chakra. So the heart chakra is like the gateway. So the first three chakras are the physical chakras, and then the top three chakras out of the seven are the non-physical chakras, I'm going to call it, right? And in the middle, right, sitting in the middle is the heart chakra. So the heart chakra is the gateway between the physical and the non-physical. And so when you open up your heart chakra, for example, it allows you to connect with people. It allows you to fully experience, you know, like your it's just and it opens up your heart, you know. So that's the heart chakra. And then we got and then the next one is the throat chakra. Throat chakra is about communication, it's about intuition. And so when you've been working on this chakra and you've opened this up, now you get intuition. Oh, that's the right direction to go. Or no, that's not the right direction to go. And then third eye, which is this one here, it's what allows you to manifest things in the world. So whatever you can imagine up here, when your this chakra is open, it'll sort of happen, you know. And then the top one is that you're so this is pretty high. And this one is when you're fully connected to God and you live in bliss. But that's not the only path, like you're saying, right? Because you know, you just believe in Jesus, you invite him in, and boom, that's
You're
it.
there.
Job,
Yeah. A
job
lot
done.
easier. Yeah.
Of course it is.
Well, the thing that's interesting too, I think the things that people find in their path to realize their purpose, or because I remember when I was seeking before I came to the Lord, there were a lot of things that I looked at, there were a lot of things that I did, and God used all of those to give me an understanding of who I am in different ways and how to relate to him. And Jesus boiled it down. My pastor mentioned this, and he boiled it down to basically two things: love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might, and love your neighbor as yourself. So it's really about loving other people. And Jesus even went further on the Sermon on the Mount when he said, love your enemies. And it's really about when I was filled with the Holy Spirit, things started changing. Like, I'm not the same as I was before. And it is a process of God changing me. And the comfort is amazing. And it's not because I'm doing all this work, it's because of what God's doing through me. And it's about being a light in the world. And the kindness, I guess I keep going back to the kindness, because the love and the kindness, Jesus says, come to me, all you who are burdened and weary and burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest, for I'm gentle and humble, and my yoke is light. And it's true. He's very, very kind. And I guess one of the things that's really nice for me is that I tried doing all that stuff. I tried really hard to make myself right or do this or that, and I was just always falling short, and there wasn't enough that I could do. And when I came to Jesus, it was like, wow, okay, he's doing it. I still do quite a bit, and I'm still learning, and there's things I have to show up and do every day, and I'm not perfect, but I have forgiveness and I'm able to live with God in a way that I get to be who I want to be, and I know I've got eternity with Him in heaven through Jesus. And with my background, my heritage being Jewish, it's the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the creator of everything. And so,
So let me ask you a quick question.
yeah.
How long did it take in your searching and your in your tribulations to finally accept and finally become one with Jesus? Like, how many years was it?
Well, when I asked Jesus to be my Lord and Savior, I was 44. And so I had really been searching for a long time, and I had been praying to God and asking to be with God since I was a little girl. I have always loved God and I've always wanted to be with God. So it
So it literally took you 40 years to eventually come to the realization, oh, hang on a minute, oh, I can just connect, right?
I had no idea that was even going to happen. Truthfully, I was sitting in church. I felt God there, and I know, I knew God. I've loved God, and He's been around and He's helped me. I didn't know He was Jesus, but I was sitting in church literally, and I'm listening to the pastor, and I'm like, I've tried everything but Jesus. Why not? I did. I literally said after I asked Jesus to be my Lord and Savior, I asked him to fill me with the Holy Spirit and to forgive me. I came out, I'm like, all right, show me what you got. If this doesn't work, I can try Buddha. I literally was like that. I knew very little. I just knew that I wasn't able to do it myself. And I had done Indian sweat lodges, I had studied, I had done all kinds of things, and I just kept coming up short. I didn't have the peace that I was looking for. And I have a peace inside of me that's amazing. And I really think when someone is searching for that comfort inside of themselves and they haven't,
Well, there's search
they,
and you shall find.
yeah, and that comes from Jesus. He
And
says
knock and
that,
knock
yeah,
and knock, and it shall
yeah.
be open to you.
Ask and you receive, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be open to you. That's the Bible. And Jesus says
And
that.
to be
And
honest, yoga, it's exactly the same. It's just different words. That's all it is.
well, the thing about it that's interesting to me is that, Satan did fall and he wants to keep people away from the Lord. And Jesus is the way. And, he's where we really get our forgiveness from. And so there are a lot of things that have been created to kind of be counterfeit in the sense of, oh yeah, it's the same thing, but it's not. You know what I mean? It's like it's there, but it isn't. And I always want to encourage people, if they haven't really considered God very much, or they haven't really thought of Jesus in terms of, he could, yeah, that could really happen. Yeah, right. I didn't know. I didn't really believe, but he really blew me away. And I always feel like he loves us so much. And some of these things, I think it's fascinating, and I respect you a lot for how much you've done. I mean, you have really gone into a path and you've done a lot of research and you do a lot of studying and you show up and you are there and you are willing to, hey, give me the instruction, I'll do it. And that's an amazing, just the fact that God has given you that is really a beautiful gift. To be able to do that. And I think that, in part of your searching and part of your journey, I think if because I didn't know what the Bible said until I read it. And when I started really learning, and it was after I came to Christ, but, I really didn't realize how amazing he was and what he had done. And I've never been so fulfilled, and I had tried so much. And so I feel like it would just kind of be a natural thing in some ways for people who are, doing a spiritual thing to look at Jesus for who he is and who the
Well,
Bible says he is.
in yoga they do talk about Jesus as well. He's a saint or in that's it. Sorry. In yoga they talk about Jesus and they talk about Muhammad as well. And in both of those, Jesus and Muhammad, they're both enlightened beings. So these are the people who've done that work.
But it's different because Jesus was born of a virgin. He actually is God. Muhammad was not God, he was a man. And Jesus was raised from the dead. Muhammad never did that.
But in terms of Buddha, for example, Buddha isn't one person. Buddha is there's been tens of thousands of Buddhas over the last, I don't know, thousands of years. And Buddha is basically somebody who's eventually, connected fully to God. You talked about hell, right? The concept of hell. In yoga, we don't have hell. What we have is karma, and do you know? Like, how can I explain it? So it's really hard to explain these things, Like when you have to, I'm quite surprised because I understand them inside my head, but then when you have to turn it into words, it becomes a lot harder.
Well, hell was fashioned by God for, Satan was a beautiful angel and he wanted to be God and he fell and a third of the angels came down to earth and hell was created for them and people who are not with the Lord are going to end up in hell. And so it's really important for people to choose the right path. Jesus said that, straight is the way and narrow is the gate that leads to eternal life and few are those who will find it. And he says on the day of judgment, a lot of people are going to come to him and say, hey, didn't I do this? Didn't I do that? And he's going to be like, I don't know you, and by then it's a little too late,
See, we don't have that concept. We have karma instead. I don't know if you understand karma.
Well, karma, my understanding of karma from before is that, you kind of get what you deserve. But the thing is that, Jesus, he forgave all that. So I'm not going to be judged. I'm with God because I get his righteousness. He died in my place. He died in your place. All of your sins are already forgiven in Christ, but for you to receive that, you have to believe in Jesus and have him as your Lord and Savior.
But well, karma is it's you talked about free will, so we all have
Yes,
free will.
we do.
But so with free will, you can you get you choose you choose you choose the actions, you choose what to do. But each of those choices, each of those decisions, the actions that you take have consequences. So if you chose wisely, for example, then the consequences of those actions or whatever you're doing is going to be good. If you chose unwisely, then the consequences are going to be bad. Yeah. And so in yoga, there is so we are so we came down here to so in yoga, what we are and what's happening is God experience himself through himself, and it's a game as in so we are basically a thought, and the whole of creation or the universe is a thought in God's head, and the purpose of life is to experience life. It's for God to experience himself through himself, because there's no separation. And so the only way God can experience himself, because he's just one being, is to create the illusion that he's many beings. And so that allows him to experience himself. So what we are is we've come down to experience life. and to then reconnect back up. Because if you look at every man and woman, they're always trying to get more, abundance. Like if you're, let's say, I don't know, oh, it's about to run out of time. Oh, not yet, no. If let's say, I don't know, let's talk about money, right? If I use that, it's just an example. So if you're earning, let's say, £1,000 a month, you'll be looking around and you'll be like, oh, I'd like to be earning £2,000 a month. And then let's say you're earning £2,000 a month, you want to earn £10,000 a month, right? And let's say you're earning £10,000 a month, you want to earn £100,000 a month, right? And let's say you're earning £1 million a month, right? Now you want to earn, well, actually, that's not enough. I want to earn £100 million a month, right? But there's no limit. That's what I'm trying to get to, is that we are hardwired that we're always trying to get to the next level. We're always trying to, in whatever way it is, some people, it's something else, right? But I'm just using money because it's an easy thing to be, yeah. And so, and we'd never be satisfied, by the way. Like, it doesn't matter if you're earning like £100 million a month, right? You won't be satisfied because you'd be like, well, yeah, but I wanna, no, but let me finish, but I wanna earn £200 million a month, or whatever it is. And the reason for that is because what we're trying to do, so God lives in what is known as infinity, right? And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to get back up there. We're trying to go back to infinity. We want to be infinite again. And so the reason we're always wanting more is we're trying to expand ourselves till eventually, so we will never be satisfied until we hit infinity, because that's what all of creation is, infinite. And so that's the reason we're always striving, because we're trying to, we're striving just like the way, like a plant is striving to get to the sun. Like, we're also trying to do the same thing. We're like a plant in that way. And that's what, so that's what, why we're created, is to strive to be, to reconnect
The thing that's interesting.
in whatever way, in whatever way. And in yoga, there's like five different ways to, or more, I think it is, of ways to connect with God. So that, and then you can follow whichever path is aligns with you. Yeah, maybe not the right word, but is whichever path you're drawn to. So there's many ways to connect. One is called karma yoga, where you go out and serve, selfless service. That allows you to eventually connect as well to God. But in yoga, the idea is that it is instant, so you can connect directly to God like that. It's just like you, for example, you connected directly to Jesus, but it took you 40 years to get to that point where you go, oh, well, hang on a minute, it's just that, right?
Well, I made the decision to go to him. But it's interesting because in the Bible, it describes how God created everything in 6 days. And every single thing that God ever put in the Bible has come true. And everything that he has prophesied that is still going to come is all lining up right now. And so when I read the Bible and I look at the world and what's happening, one of the most stunning things that happened was in 1948, May 17th, Israel became a nation again. And God had said that Israel would become a nation again. And it hadn't been a nation for 2,000 years. And in one day, bam, it was a nation. And Mark Twain had gone to Israel. I think it was in the late 1800s, and he said it was a desolate place. I mean, I don't even think there was a tree there. And now they're producing, they're exporting tons of fruit and produce, and they've got like massive oil fields, and they've got, they're like one of the wealthiest countries at the size of New Jersey. And that was all prophesied in the Bible. And all these things that God said were going to happen are all coming true. And what's happening in the end times, which is the period of where we're at right now, everything is lining up. And I think that reading the Bible has really opened my eyes to seeing God in a new light too. because he created this. He knows the beginning from the end. And the Bible is his story with man and his creation. And I think it's a good read for people. Some of it can be confusing, but there are a lot of really good Bible teachers right now, really talking about what's going on. And just the way things are happening in the world right now with the pandemic and the natural disasters and the economy and famines and, the wars, all prophesied. And the solutions of what people are wanting to do to make everything better, that's all prophesied. It's all lining up. It's all coming to happen.
Can I just quickly interrupt you? So we've got about 4 or 5 minutes left on the timer. What three things would you like to give as a takeaway to my readers, or listeners, sorry. What three things do you think to lead a good successful life? What three things would you recommend, or you do yourself, or
I think it's praying, talking to God, asking him for guidance, wisdom, understanding. I'd say definitely ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior and fill you with the Holy Spirit and forgive you so you can have salvation. That's for free. And then really just, I would say, be in gratitude. Love God, love people. Just understand the gift that we have here and stay in a mindset of really looking for the good.
excellent, excellent. And then how do people connect with you if they want to connect with you? What's the best way?
I've got an Instagram page. It's called Gospel Glass because I'm doing it's a ministry. I'm doing fused glass birds, and it's really a metaphor. We come into the world and it's just broken pieces. And then when we come to Christ, we become a new creation. We're filled with His light and the Holy Spirit, and we become really beautiful. And so these birds are all made with broken pieces, and then they're fired in the kiln. And there's a gospel story and stuff.
And so,
So,
be and people can just message you on Instagram. I'm guessing, and then and you'll connect with them.
There's scripture and hymns and quotes and stuff. I've got some new music that's going to be coming out soon, so it's
Okay.
fun.
And what was your channel called again? I missed the
It's Gospel Glass.
Gospel Glass. Okay,
Yeah.
Angus Gospel Glass, and you're based in Texas. So
Yeah.
if and do you have like a meeting, a group meeting that you have in Texas that people, if they wanted to connect with you, they could.
I haven't said anything else like that,
Okay.
so. I have Bible studies I go to and things like that, but I haven't set up a group. If people wanted to set up a group, we could certainly do that.
Yeah. Okay, brilliant. So thank you very much.
This was
This is
so nice talking to you,
I
and thank
love
you
that.
for sharing all the things that you've been doing too, because you're seeking as well.
Everybody's seeking. Well, I from what I've figured out, everybody's seeking. Even
Yeah.
the plants are seeking. Even the lizards on the ground are seeking. Everybody's seeking.
Yeah.
And but yeah. So, yeah. So thank you very much. This has been very entertaining and very enlightening for me.
Oh, I'm
Just to
glad.
see,
I've learned a lot
see.
from you too.
Yeah, just to see the other side. You know, like the other people and how they're following their path as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, thank you very much. I'll put all your links at the bottom,
Thank
and
you.
I'll send you a link, you know, once I've get it all this process. I've got like six
Yeah.
videos to process, and I'll put them out on YouTube and on my podcast,
Okay, great.
and they'll end up on Instagram and Facebook and all that kind of stuff.
And if
So,
anyone has any prayer requests, they can contact me. I love praying for people.
oh, brilliant! Yeah, that'd be good to it. Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank
It's
you.
been awesome connecting with you. I wish you an amazing day, a week, month, year.
You too. Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure, Joe.
Thank you.
Take
Bye.
care.
Bye.
Bye.